gmail.com.
محمد رسول الله عليه الصلاة والسلام.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وبه نستعين ونصلي ونسلم على خاتم النبيين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، respected listeners, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Today is Tuesday, the 8th of August 2006. Welcome to yet another lesson as we go through the tafsir of Surah Yusuf. Just before beginning, once again, let's just clear out a question that is here from yesterday. You mentioned an important point in regards to the Muslims not reading the Quran. The question is saying basically that I did make a point at the beginning of the tafsir when we were speaking about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying that we revealed to you the Quran in Arabic, and we're mentioning the importance of a Muslim actually reading his own book, as the Quran is a constitution of a believer. And obviously here the question is saying that there are some other scholars who actually advise against the normal public actually reading the Quran or the meaning of the Quran or the tafsir, as that may lead to them going astray. Now obviously Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the book, in his own book, he says, وَلَقَدْ يَسَّرْنَا الْقُرْآنَ لِلذِّكْرِ فَهَلْ مِمُدَّكِرٍ, that we have made the Quran easy for one to remember, for one to understand. فَهَلْ مِمُدَّكِرٍ, so is there anyone who will read and understand? So it is incorrect for us to advise the Muslim public not to read their book, or only to read it if they have a scholar with them. Obviously when you do read your book and you the Quran, and you find that in certain circumstances you are not understanding properly, etc., then you have to get acquainted with your ulama and question them and ask them to clarify matters. But to say openly that you shouldn't read your book, this is against the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He says, أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ أَمْ عَلَىٰ قُلُوبٍ أَقْفَالُهَا, that do you not ponder over the Quran? Do you not ponder its teachings? Do you not learn and read the teaching that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed in it? أَمْ عَلَىٰ قُلُوبٍ أَقْفَالُهَا, or is it that you have a lock upon your hearts? May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us from this. So we wouldn't say that you shouldn't read the book. We say read the Quran from cover to cover, just as you read other novels. The Quran has more right of being read because you are a Muslim, a servant of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is your constitution, and you should know what is required of you. And yes, there will be cases where you need explanations from the ulama. Contact them as soon as possible, because that's why they are there, and clarify some difficulties, discrepancies or misconceptions that one may have when understanding the meaning. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make it easy. A request is made for my cell phone number. Yes, by all means, you may have my cell phone number if I may find it. That's 082-229-0834. 08-222-90834. This is the number that I use when I'm in South Africa. In fact, you can get me on email at any time. It's Sajid Ahmed, S-A-J-I-D-A-H-M-E-D. That's one word. Sajid Ahmed, then a dot, then Umar, U-M-A-R, at gmail.com. Sajid Ahmed dot Umar at gmail.com. Moving on with the tafsir, yesterday we stopped at the point where now the brothers wanted to put their plan into effect. So they went to their father, and I said they used a lot of emotional politics and emotional blackmail. They went to me and said, what is wrong with you that you don't trust us with Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam? Why is it that when it comes to him, you don't even trust us with him, when in actual fact we are his brothers? Wa inna lahu lanasihun, we are from amongst those who advise him and counsel him. We are his well wishers. And then they told him, أَرْسِلْهُ مَعَنَا غَدَ يَرْتَعْ وَيَلْعَبْ وَإِنَّا لَهُ لَحَافِظٌ, that send him with us tomorrow so we can play and be together. وَإِنَّا لَهُ لَحَافِظٌ, and we are to him protectors. We will protect him. So they plotted the plan against Yusuf. Now they put their plan into effect. So they tell Ya'qub alayhi salatu wasalam this. Now obviously Ya'qub alayhi salatu wasalam, as I said, being overprotective of this young boy, he was in his infancy. Some ulama say 7, some say 8. In any case, it was definitely under the age of 10. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. He needs guidance. As I said, some ulama mentioned that his mother passed away whilst he was an infant. If that was the case, then even more so, more reason for Ya'qub alayhi salatu wasalam to be overprotective of his son. Remember, the other brothers were big in age, and there was a possibility that they would neglect him, and he put it through to them when he said, قَالَ إِنِّي لَيَحْزُنُنِي أَن تَذْهَبُوا بِهِ وَأَخَافُ, وأخاف أن يأكله الذئب وأنتم عنه غافلون. He said that I am, or it saddens me to let him go with you. It worries me that I let him out of my sight, I let him go with you, and I am scared that a wolf may eat him whilst you are unaware. You might be too busy playing or competing with one another or doing certain things. Obviously, he's young, he can't be with you in everything that you do. There might be a circumstance that you might be ignorant of him, you might leave him in a certain place, you might forget about him for a little while, and that little moment something could happen to them. Now, Ya'qub alayhi salatu wasalam, we should remember, was a prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he heard Yusuf's dream. Remember at the beginning, Yusuf narrates his dream to his father about the sun, the moon, and the 11 stars. Now, the ulama have mentioned that he may have not known the exact details about it, but as a prophet, he realized that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had a lot in store for his son. He knew that Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam would reach a very high status and he would be of very great caliber. So with all this in mind, could he really and truly be worried of a wolf eating his son? I mean, did he really contemplate the aspect of a wolf eating his son, or did he just say it? So some of the ulama say that yes, he was genuinely scared, because if he didn't worry about a wolf eating his son, then he would be lying. So he was genuinely scared. Now some of the other ulama say that no, he wasn't actually scared of a wolf eating his son, but he was aware that something could happen to him. These people could plot against him, and he used this as an excuse to be diplomatic with them. However, in the same breath, he was not lying about the wolf. Even though he may have not been worried truly that a wolf would actually consume or attack or eat Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, but he mentioned it as a form of tawriyah. Now, tawriyah in the Arabic language is when you say something and the thing that you say has two meanings. The thing that you say has two meanings. So you intend the further meaning. You intend the further meaning. For example, when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was going to Medina and a ransom was put on him, and he was with Abu Bakr radiallahu an, and somebody saw Abu Bakr radiallahu an and recognized him and came to Abu Bakr radiallahu an and said, "Who is this person with you?" Meaning Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, "Who is he?" Now obviously, if he said that this is Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he would have been captured because there was a ransom put on him. So Abu Bakr radiallahu an said, "He's my guide. He is my guide." Now a guide in that circumstance had two meanings. Obviously Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is all our guides. He came and guided us from the darkness and put us into the light. But that person interpreted the closer meaning that he is Abu Bakr's guide. He's showing him the way. Obviously those days they had to travel through the deserts, etc. And they needed guides to show them the best routes, etc. Where the wells would be and stuff such as those, meaning the things that you would actually think about when you're traveling. And remember, it was in they used to travel by camel. The distances were far. There was no air conditioning as we have today. It was a hot desert, so they would plan their route through places that had wells, or there would be water along the way, or places for them to rest. So obviously they would take guides. So Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu told this person that he is my guide. Now the guide had two meanings. Abu Bakr meant he's my guide. He's taken me from the dark period into the period of Islam. But that person translated it as his, meaning Abu Bakr's actual guide, showing him the way. So this is tawriyah. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. And some might say that why do we mention this difference of opinion? Obviously we are doing this tafsir and we're trying to do justice to it. We are speaking on air. And when you speak on air, you face the possibility of reaching a large audience. Those who might be studying Islam, and I do know for a fact, as I've received some emails from the UK, there are students from the Darul Ulums over there actually tuning into the program. So it is of benefit that we try and mention everything. There's no need for us to get confused here. This is the depth of the Arabic language, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala left it unknown. There's no need for us to go deep into whether he was actually using tawriyah or whether he was actually worried that his son would be eaten by a wolf. But the ulama have discussed it, and for beneficial purposes I include it. So we learnt an important lesson from this, and that is the aspect of tawriyah. Tawriyah is not actually lying. It's when you say something which has two meanings. You intend the further meaning, but the person listening to you understands the closer meaning. So Ya'qub alayhi salatu wasalam places his fear to his children. So the children respond by saying, قَالُوا لَئِنْ أَكَلَهُ الذِّئْبُ وَنَحْنُ عُصْبَةٌ إِنَّا إِذَا لَخَاسِرُونَ. That if he is with us, if he, Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, is with us, and we are so large in number, and a wolf actually eats him, then indeed, without doubt, we are from the losers. Because we're so big in number, it's impossible for him to be attacked by a wolf when we're such, when we're actually a group, Uspa, we are a large group of people. So this is how they responded to their father. So they were trying to remove the last fears that Ya'qub alayhi salatu wasalam had. I mean, now he had nothing to say to them, obviously, because they've actually planned it well. He mentioned to them his fear. They said, look, we're large in number. If anything happens, then we'll be from the losers. It's practically impossible for anything to happen to him. So then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala continues telling us the story. He says, فَلَمَّا ذَهَبُوا بِهِ وَأَجْمَعُوا أَن يَجْعَلُوهُ فِي غَيَابَةِ الْجُبْ. So when they took him out and agreed to put him into the bottom of a well. Remember, they were planning on killing him, and the oldest brother said, look, don't kill him. If you are going to do something, then throw him in the bottom of a well. They had a consensus about it. They managed to get him out away from their father, and they agreed. They went and they threw him in the well. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَأَوْحَيْنَا إِلَيْهِ لَتُنَبِّئَنَّهُمْ بِأَمْرِهِمْ هَذَا وَهُمْ لَا يَشْعُرُونَ. And we inspired him and revealed to him that you will surely inform these brothers of yours one day about this affair of theirs, about them getting rid of you and throwing you into this well, while they perceive not, whilst they don't recognize you. Now, I am going to discuss this ayah a bit, because in it there's lessons. Remember, we spoke about Jawami'ul Kalim, the beautiness of the Arabic language, the power that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has when revealing his book, when revealing the Quran, that in so little words we take so much. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells little Yusuf, a young boy, let us put ourselves in the frame of mind, or try to, of Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. Young boy, so handsome, well-mannered, pious. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shows at an early stage of his life that there are good things to come to this boy. Then 11 brothers come, cheat him away from his father, using emotional politics, emotional blackmail, whatever you may use to it. He's totally innocent. He's excited. I'm going out with my brothers. They take him, they harass him, they move him to this well far away from where his home is, and then they throw him into the well. Subhanallah. Just imagine, to my mothers and fathers listening out there, if it was your own child, what would you do thinking about your 7-year-old child lost somewhere in Johannesburg? Never mind being at the bottom of a well. Lost somewhere in the city. So he is at the bottom of a well, and his shirt is removed from him, as that was part of the plan. So his shirt is not with him, and he's in the bottom of the well, and he might be thinking, my brothers are playing with me. And then he hears these footsteps disappearing slowly. The footsteps slowly disappear, and all of a sudden, he is totally by himself. Subhanallah. Now the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon him. Remember one thing, respected elders and brothers. Allah Rabbul Izzati wal Jalal revealed to his prophets between the ages of 30 and 40. He sent them divine revelation between the ages of 30 and 40. Here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, when Yusuf was in the well at a very young age, وَأَوْحَيْنَا إِلَيْهِ. Now the ulama have said that this was revelation, and some others said it wasn't revelation, it was inspiration, it was ilham. Ilham means a type of inspiration whereby you understand something. But others have said it was revelation, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَأَوْحَيْنَا. In any case, there's a long discussion in regards to it. However, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala inspired him, revealed him, a young boy, 7 years old, without hope, left in the well, away from his mother, away from his father, and the brothers who you place your trust in desert you, leave you out there for dead. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, through his mercy, inspires and reveals to Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam and says, لَتُنَبِّئَنَّهُمْ. You will indeed, the beauty of the Arabic language once again, لَتُنَبِّئَنَّهُمْ. This lam is for ta'keed, for to make something, you know, when you're speaking, you can speak in such a way that you may express yourself more. This lam over here that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed, لَتُنَبِّئَنَّهُمْ, is a type of expression. Allah is making it certain and expressing his view to him that indeed the day will definitely come that you will inform your brothers of this evil action of theirs, وَهُمْ لَا يَشْعُرُونَ, and they won't even know you, they won't even identify you. So, what do we learn from this ayah besides what I've told you already, the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Allah tells him this. We learn from it a few things. Things which come to my mind right now is that first and foremost, you would definitely understand that I'm not going to die over here. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, one day you will inform them. What does that mean? That means you're not going to die now, meaning you're going to live for a period. The day is still going to come, so your days are not over. Immediately, this is what we understand from this ayah. The second thing that we understand is that Yusuf alayhi salam would definitely have status. How do we know this? Because Allah said, وَهُمْ لَا يَشْعُرُونَ, that they will not recognize you. So the fact that they won't recognize him means he will be of great status. He will be somebody that they would never imagine. He would be in a position that they would never imagine a boy thrown in the well at the age of 7 could reach that status or reach that position. So indeed he would have great status. So firstly, he won't die. Allah said, you will tell them, future, he won't die. He understands that his days are not over in the well. The second point is that he will have great status. Why? Because they won't recognize him. A third point that comes to mind very quickly is that Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam will be above them, as he will be the one informing them. Allah says, you will inform them. Just like a father informs his son, and a teacher informs his or her student. So he would be in a higher position. He would be in a higher position, a position that he could do, or he will be doing the informing, and they will be doing the listening. Then we also learn that Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam will be reunited with his family. Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam will be reunited with his family. Why do we know this? Because Allah said, you will inform them. So that means he is going to be reunited with them. The time will come when they will actually meet. So that's another point. And the fifth point that comes to mind is this ayah, this inspiration, this revelation at that time. Someone would be so scared, a young boy, a dark well, in the middle of nowhere. In the middle of nowhere, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala appeased him. Appeased Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. And only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows the exact fear that can exist within a young boy after suffering a horrible torment such as that. So subhanallah, in this one ayah, we learn all these teachings. So this ayah actually appeased Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, gave him hope, and it gave him hope that inshallah he won't be, he has time to live. The well is not the end of his life. It's not the end of days. He will move on to bigger and better things. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is upon all able. Now the story actually moves into another phase. A phase where Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam is gone. He's no more with his father. The plan is carried out. They plotted and planned against him. The plan has gone successful. And now they have to go back to their father. These brothers, they have to go back, or these sons have to go back to their father. Minus who? Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. So he was in the picture all along. Now he's out of the picture, but only temporary. So they go back to their father. وَجَاءُوا أَبَاهُمْ عِشَاءً يَبْكُونَ. And they came to their father at night. Isha, meaning at the time of Isha, the early part of the night. Weeping, subhanallah. Weeping. Convincingly. They want to convince the father of this horrible event that just took place. Obviously, they're going to be lying to their father. And we'll speak about this later. That remember, they said, we'll get rid of him and we'll be good. We'll purify ourselves. Now they still have to lie. So they're coming and they're crying. Fake tears, crocodile tears, whatever you may call it. So they came to their father at the early part of the night, at the time of Isha, which is the early part of the night, and they were crying. And what did they have in plan? They had in plan the usage of the same fear that Ya'qub alayhi salatu wasalam told them. Remember, he said, I fear a wolf will eat him. He revealed to them a fear. They were going to use that same fear against him. They were going to use that same fear against him. They were going to tell him that, listen, Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam was eaten by a wolf. So this is what their plan was. They came back crying, and now they were going to use the last fear that Ya'qub alayhi salatu wasalam had for his son. And that's why those who specialize in the tactics of warfare, etc., they mention, never ever release to your enemy any fears that you might have, because they might just use that same fear against you. Anyway, so they came crying, a befitting picture. They all upset, they all up in arms, and they go and they say, Ya Abana, inna dhahabna nastabiq wa tarakna Yusuf 'inda mata'ina fa akalahu adh-dhi'b wa ma anta bimu'minin lana walau kunna sadiqin. La ilaha illa Allah. They say, oh, our father, indeed we went racing with one another, we had a competition with one another, and we left Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam with our possessions, with our belongings, and whilst we were racing and involved in competition with one another, a wolf came out and devoured him and ate him. And then what makes it worse? Their last statement, emotional blackmail. وما أنت بمؤمن لنا ولو كنا صادقين. And you will never ever believe us, even though we are truthful. Subhanallah. They tell the father what happened, and now they say, look, we know you're not going to believe us. You're not going to believe us even though we are true. He hasn't said anything yet. They've informed him, he hasn't even responded, but obviously emotional blackmail, trying to get through, hit the soft parts of the heart of Ya'qub alayhi salatu wasalam. You're trying to convince him that something actually happened to Yusuf when they were in fact responsible for breaking this family, breaking the brotherhood and getting rid of a young boy who was blessed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And they tell their father, hitting him, that listen, we're telling you what happened and we know you're not going to believe us even though we are truthful. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knew best. So we learn here the impact of using emotional blackmail. And I want to take time out just to speak a bit about it, because it's something that exists within a lot of people. And I find this out especially when we try and assist some of the youth when they're having a bit of problems at home in regards to their mothers, their fathers. And the biggest circumstance would be whereby they might have an interest in marrying a certain girl, or the girl might have an interest in marrying a certain boy. But then we are faced with this un-Islamic belief of tribalism, of caste, whereby parents feel that no, they should marry a certain tribe and a certain caste, etc. So what happens? The mothers go into the selfish mode and they use emotional blackmail against their own children. Instead of sitting and looking at what is in front of us, this boy, my son, who I love, who I brought up, who is the coolness of my eyes, he is a good boy, and now he's interested in marrying this girl, let us at least take the chance, look at the girl, is she Islamically inclined or not, or it's look at the pros and the cons of the situation. Immediately we say, no, this girl is from another caste, or this boy is from another caste, and you are not doing it. So we behave selfishly. And then some mothers use, or some fathers use, this emotional blackmail, whereby they go and say that if you do it, don't even come to my grave. A'udhu billah. And I know right now, those who are listening at home, some of us or some of you might be actually remembering a time that you might have heard the statement being said. And I've heard it many a time. This is emotional blackmail, my dear listeners. We need to fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and not be oppressive to anybody. A person who uses emotional blackmail is in actual fact being oppressive. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not love the oppressors. Remember, you are a servant of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and not a servant of your desires. You will do what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said and not what you feel is right. Whatever Allah determined right will be right, even though you might have another feeling to it. And at the end of the day, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Prophet decreed something upon you, it was never decreed upon you in such a way that you felt that you had a choice in the matter. So when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught us, and the reason why I'm speaking about the aspect of marriage is because this is the gist of the problems that the youth are facing at the moment. And this is this emotional blackmail. I term it as emotional blackmail. For a mother or a father to tell their child, if you do this, don't bother coming to my grave. This is emotional blackmail in the highest degree. You cannot play. Obviously, no son, no daughter, after hearing this, will actually, you know, go against their parents. Some would, but no child, meaning who has a good relationship with his parents, would actually do this. In fact, it will burn him or burn her and eat her up more. So parents are advised against this oppressive quality of using emotional blackmail. Here, the children of Ya'qub alayhi salatu wasalam are hurting him further. They use the emotional blackmail against him that, look, this is what happened, and you're not going to believe us, even though we are truthful. He hasn't even responded to them and they're doing this. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us from this. Let us think, my dear parents, and this is also for the children. Let us think before we speak out. Let us stop, think, analyze what we're going to say, and look at the impact that it might have on the next person. And this is from Islam, a way of life. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam always taught us to think before we speak. Don't just speak and then regret later. Don't be emotional, be in control. What happens in most cases with emotional blackmail? It happens in a case where the person speaking is not in control. his or she is in a phase where they're not in control of the condition or the situation that is at hand, and they start lashing out with words that really can hurt the next person or the person listening to. So we ask Allah listening to them. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala his protection from this evil quality. It is a quality of shaitan, and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us the ability to put Islam first. Islam first before our tribal or cultural beliefs, because we are Muslims before we are anything else. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the understanding. So they used the emotional blackmail, and then they were crying, they broke the news to the father, they used the emotional blackmail, and then what else did they do? Remember, they took Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam's shirt. So to drive the point home to their father, وَجَاءُوا عَلَىٰ قَمِيسِهِ بِدَمٍ كَذِبٍ. They came to their father with the shirt of Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam filled with blood. بِدَمٍ كَذِبٍ. Lying blood. Blood which was not the blood of Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. Blood which was from, as the ulama of tafsir mentioned, a lamb that was slaughtered, and that blood was used to stain the shirt of Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. Now remember, they said, we'll just get rid of him and then we'll be good people. Shaitan's deception. They got rid of Yusuf. Then what did they have to do? They had to slaughter an animal with the intention of evil. Then what else did they have to do? They had to come and pretend like they were crying, deceiving. These are qualities of shaitan to their father, which was an act of evil. Then they had to lie to their father using the shirt and so much more, and the emotional blackmail thing. So there is never this aspect that, let me just do this haram and this bad and afterwards I will be good. This is a deception from shaitan. Prevention is better than cure. Stop yourself before you get involved too much in it. Once you do a crime, you have to do so many other crimes afterwards to cover up if you can. And no crime is perfect, as we will see here. So if you do a crime, you'll have to do so many other crimes and so many other evils afterwards to try and cover up that first crime. And in most cases, it's not. And we will see that right now. So they came with the shirt of Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. They said, you won't believe us. Here's a shirt. It's filled with blood. So then Yaqub alayhi salatu wasalam doesn't believe them. How do we know he doesn't believe them? He says, قَالَ بَلْ سَوَّلَتْ لَكُمْ أَنفُسُكُمْ أَمْرًا. قَالَ بَلْ سَوَّلَتْ لَكُمْ أَنفُسُكُمْ أَمْرًا. That you have indeed done something. You have indeed done something. I don't believe that he has actually been eaten by a wolf. So they brought upon the shirt, or his shirt, with false blood. Yaqub alayhi salam said, rather your souls have enticed you to do something. I don't believe that he's been eaten by a wolf. You people are lying. There's something going on here. He didn't believe them. فَصَبْرٌ جَمِيلٌ. And for me, in this circumstance, is a beautiful patience. وَاللَّهُ الْمُسْتَعَانُ عَلَىٰ مَا تَصِفُونَ. And I place my trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is enough for me for this thing that you are describing. Now, why didn't Yaqub alayhi salatu wasalam actually believe what these brothers were saying? First and foremost, remember, he heard the dream of Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. So he knew that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had something great in store for this young boy. That's the first point. The second point, and this is mentioned by the ulama of tafsir, is that they came to Yaqub alayhi salatu wasalam with a shirt filled with blood, but the shirt was totally intact. The shirt was totally intact. Now, how can a wolf eat up a boy, a young boy, and stain the entire shirt with blood, or parts of it with blood, but the shirt is totally intact? There is no ripping, there is no tearing, there are no signs of teeth bites. So this was a mistake from their side. The ulama of tafsir have mentioned this. Now, those who work with the crime squads and those who study the laws of criminology will know an important law, and that is the law that no crime can be completely flawless. No crime can be completely flawless. No plan or no crime can be perfect. There's nothing like a perfect crime. There are always mistakes that are there, and the professionals who go to the scenes of the crime and study it, obviously their job and they or the thing that they meant to do is look for these mistakes. So there's no crime that is flawless. There has to be a mistake, and this was their mistake, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. So Yaqub alayhi salatu wasalam doesn't believe them, and he says, for me is a beautiful patience. Subhanallah, look at the words Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses here. فَصَبْرٌ جَمِيلٌ. A beautiful patience, a long patient patience. I will just put my trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is enough for me for this thing that you are describing, for this evil act that you have done. Whatever has happened, I place my trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. My dear mother, my dear father, if you had lost your child, or somebody came home and said your child was hit by a car, we can't say eaten by a wolf, we live in the cities now, but if we say he was hit by a car, what would happen to you personally? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala must protect all our children. But can you imagine the emotions that will overtake you? Would or do, I mean, it's impossible to imagine. But how much patience could one actually hold in this circumstance? That in an instant, your child is gone. He wants to go out and play with friends. You tell him, listen son, be careful of the cars, be careful of this, be careful of that. You're a parent who never lets your child go out. He's always at home or she's always at home. And just this once, you let your child go out and he doesn't come back. Instead, you get news at night that he's been hit by a car. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. How would you feel at that moment? So look at Yaqub alayhi salatu wasalam. I mean, some parents would tell you now that we would actually go mental. Subhanallah. We would scream, we would be out of control. And this is the lesson of patience that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasalam taught us. And here Yaqub alayhi salatu wasalam says, I have a beautiful patience, subhanallah. I place my trust totally in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is enough for me for whatever you people are describing. My dear mothers, my dear fathers, my dear brothers and sisters, patience is a valuable quality that insan needs to have, that mankind needs to have, especially a Muslim. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is with those who are patient. He said, Inna Allah ma'as sabirin. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given glad tidings to those who are patient. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, Wa bashiru sabirin. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asked us and asks us to seek assistance in our problems by being patient. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَاسْتَعِينُوا بِالصَّبْرِ وَالصَّلَةِ وَاسْتَعِينُوا بِالصَّبْرِ وَالصَّلَةِ. Seek assistance by being patient and in your salah. And this is what Ya'qub alayhi salatu wasalam, he sought assistance by being patient. وَاللَّهُ الْمُسْتَعَانُ عَلَى مَا تَصِفُونَ. And then he was patient, and after that he placed his trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He put all affairs in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. اللهم إني أسلمت نفسي إليك. He put everything in front of Allah. وَاللَّهُ الْمُسْتَعَانُ عَلَى مَا تَصِفُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is enough for me in what you people or you are describing. So with patience he placed his trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I mean, subhanAllah, it was the means of salvation for him. I mean, there's nothing else that one can do in that circumstance to keep themselves or to console themselves. Obviously, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam teaches us in a hadith that a believer is in a win-win situation. A believer is in a win-win situation, meaning every circumstance for him is good. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives him something, some good, he thanks Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that is good for him. And if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tests him with something, maybe someone passes away, maybe he loses a bit of wealth, maybe he's hungry for a few days, maybe he's not well, this is all tests from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَلَنَبْلُوَنَّكُمْ بِشَيْءٍ مِّنَ الْخَوْفِ. Maybe he's fearing something. وَالْجُوعِ وَنَقْصٍ مِّنَ الْأَمْوَالِ وَالْأَنفُسِ وَالثَّمَرَاتِ. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tests him or tests her with so many different things. Maybe there's family problems, maybe there's marriage problems, maybe there's children problems, so many things depressing us and distressing us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَبَشِّرِ الصَّابِرِينَ. Give glad tidings to those who are patient. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that if good comes to him, he thanks Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or she thanks Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that is good for them. And if Allah tests them with something, then they are patient. And that also is good for them and a reward for them. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from amongst those who thank him and those who are patient. Remember, dear listeners, as taught to us by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, إِذَا أَحَبَّ اللَّهُ أَحَدًا إِبْتَلَاهُ. That if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves anybody, Allah will test them. So the fact that you are being tested, be patient and know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves you. With every test that Allah gives you, he raises you in rank. The more tests that you pass, the higher rank that you get in Jannah, and the closer you get to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Just like in this dunya, the more exams you pass, the more qualifications you get. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us patience. We spoke about tawakkul. Remember, after Ya'qub alayhi salatu wasalam had patience in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said, وَاللَّهُ الْمُسْتَعَانُ عَلَى مَا تَصِفُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is enough for me. This is tawakkul. This is an important aspect of a believer in regards to his relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Just as being patient is an important aspect as well, tawakkul is also a criteria. And this is how you place your trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, how you live everything by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You put your trust in Him, you seek assistance from Him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, ala kulli shay'in qadir. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is upon all able. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, wa ala Allahi falyatawakkal almu'minun. That in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, a believer places trust. So if you are a believer, you place your trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also mentions, inni tawakkaltu ala Allahi rabbi wa rabbakum, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mentioning that He said that I have placed my trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, rabbi wa rabbikum, my trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is my Rabb, my creator, my sustainer, my nourisher, and your creator as well. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ آمَنَّا بِهِ وَعَلَيْهِ تَوَكَّلْنَا. That say, in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I believe and I have placed my trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, placing your trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, dear listeners, is extremely important. It is criteria. It's got to do with your relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Today, we find the Muslim ummah suffering a lot of trials, tribulations, depressions, anxieties, high cost of living. A lot of things depress us and distress us. It might be problems in the homes or whatever it may be. We need to put our trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. At the end of the day, your job description is to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and it's Allah's subhanahu wa ta'ala's promise to feed you, to provide for you, to assist you. So always place your trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala first, before even contemplating the fact of turning to the people. If you are in need of help, ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala first, because the help you are asking for, it's Allah who can help you. And if you think that someone else can help you, it's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who is helping that person as well. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the true understanding of as-sabr, which is patience, and at-tawakkul, which is placing one's trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The story moves on. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, right, so they went to their father, they told their father the story. He said, I place my trust in Allah and I'll be patient. Now Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam is in the well. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then says, وَجَاءَتْ سَيَّارَةٌ فَأَرْسَلُوا وَارِدَهُمْ فَأَدْلَى دَلْوَى. That a sayyara came, a caravan, a group of people, a group of travelers passed by the well. And they sent those who are with the caravan that actually look for the water, and requested them to go fill up the bucket. So they actually went. Fa'adla dalwa. Adla dalwa means they lowered their buckets into the well. Obviously, you lower your bucket into the well, it gets filled up with water, and the water, you pull the bucket back up with water. So they lowered their buckets into the well. And what happened when they pulled it up? They found Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. They found this young handsome boy. So immediately they said, Qala ya bushra hadha ghulam. They said, good news, here is a boy. We're looking for water. Instead, we have found a boy. وَأَسَرُّهُ بِضَاءَ. And what did they do with him? Now look at the test, subhanAllah. This young boy, look at the test he is going through at such a young stage of his life. And we thought we all had problems. Imagine, he was left for dead, and now all of a sudden, he's taken out of this well, not free. وَأَسَرُّهُ بِضَاءَ. They concealed him as merchandise. They hid him and kidnapped him, you can say. أَسَرُّهُ بِضَاءَ. They hid him and concealed him as merchandise. وَاللَّهُ عَلِيمٌ بِمَا يَعْمَلُونَ. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is all knowledgeable of what they did. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most knowledgeable of what they did. أَلَا لَهُ الْخَلْقُ وَالْأَمْرُ تَبَارَكَ اللَّهُ رَبُّ الْعَالَمِينَ. That indeed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is all creation and all things that happen. Tabarakallah. Praise be to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is the Lord of the world. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, we are all aware of what they did. So, as we said, he was oppressively removed from his parents, then left in the darkness of a well. Now removed, and he might have thought he was free. All of a sudden, he's not free. He's kidnapped and concealed as merchandise. And as I said, we thought we have problems. Respected listeners, do our problems even come close to what young Yusuf, under the age of 10, alayhi salatu wasalam, went through? And this, respected listeners, is just the beginning. There's a lot more to come. So, fasten your seatbelts. I mean, we can actually say fasten your seatbelts, because he's gone through a lot and there's a lot more to come. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, now he's transported out. وَشَرَوْهُ بِثَمَنٍ بَخْسٍ دَرَاهِمَ مَعَدُودَ. We should remember these caravans, they travel from place to place. So they considered him as merchandise. They weren't going to stay in Palestine. They were obviously traveling to another place. And as we will see, they traveled to Egypt. So imagine a young boy without consent is being kidnapped and taken with no choice to a foreign land. وَشَرَوْهُ بِثَمَنٍ بَخْسْ دَرَاهِمَ مَعْدُودَ And they sold him for a paltry sum. A small amount, meaning they had no need for him. They had no need for Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, and they said, let's just get rid of him. They sold him beyond his wish for a paltry sum. وَكَانُوا فِيهِ مِنَ الزَّاهِدِينَ They had no need for Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. Now, as per methodology, we said we will always listen to the recitation and then continue. The last recitation we had ended here. So right now, before continuing, we will listen to the recitation and then continue with the tafsir.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم
وقال الذي اشتراه من مصر لامرأته أكرمي مثواه عسى أن ينفعنا أو نتخذه ولدا وكذلك مكنا ليوسف في الأرض ولنعلمه من تأويل الأحاديث والله غالب على أمره ولكن أكثر الناس لا يعلمون ولما بلغ أشده آتيناه حكما وعلما وكذلك نجزي المحسنين وراودته التي هو في بيتها عن نفسه وغلقت الأبواب وقالت هيت لك قال معاذ الله إنه ربي أحسن مثواي إنه لا يفلح الظالمون ولقد همت به وهم بها لولا أن رأى برهان ربه كذلك لنصرف عنه السوء والفحشاء إنه من عبادنا المخلصين واستبق الباب وقدت قميصه من دبر وألف يا سيدها لدى الباب قالت ما جزاء من أراد بأهلك سوءا إلا أن يسجن أو عذاب أليم قال هي راودتني عن نفسي وشهد شاهد من أهلها إن كان قميصه قد من قبل فصدقت وهو من الكاذبين وإن كان قميصه قد من دبر فكذبت وهو من الصادقين فلما رأى قميصه قد من دبر قال إنه من كيدكن إن كيدكن عظيم يوسف أعرض عن هذا واستغفري لذنبك إنك كنت من الخاطئين
Yes, the beautiful words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the manner in which he narrates to us the story which is the best of all stories. In fact, all the stories in the Quran are the best of all stories. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us the understanding of these beautiful chapters. And as we said at the beginning, we have to read our book, respected listeners. There's nothing that is there. We can't say by reading it, you will go astray because the Quran is meant to grant us guidance. And obviously, if we do find ourselves not understanding certain things, then we should make sure that we contact the ulama and find out from them. That's why they are there. They are there to be used. We need to make sure that we have a relationship with the ulama and we encourage our children to have a relationship with the ulama. And in the same case, the ulama must open doors and try and educate the youth that they are welcome. We have 1 minute to go before the end of the program. Inshallah, we'll continue with the tafsir tomorrow from this recitation that we just heard. We'll continue from where we stopped off. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us the understanding. Obviously, we should always ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive us whilst we have breath and whilst we are alive. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive us for anything besides shirk. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَقْبَلُ التَّوْبَةَ الْعَبْدِ مَا لَمْ يُغَرْغِرْ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepts the plea of a believer for forgiveness as long as he hasn't tasted death. Everything wrong that I've said here is from myself and shaitan, and I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala his forgiveness, and everything correct is from Allah, and Allah is the most praised. وَصَلَى اللَّهُ وَسَلَّمَ وَبَارَكَ عَلَى نَبِيِّنَا مُحَمَّدٍ وَعَلَى آلِهِ وَصَحْبِهِ أَجْمَعِينَ.